Hello learners, good afternoon to everybody. On behalf of Indira Gandhi National Open University, we welcome you for this interactive video lecture session. Today's topic is geothermal energy. I am Subhashish Maji, professor in School of Engineering and Technology from Indira Gandhi National Open University. We welcome you for this video lecture session. So, let us begin our discussion on the topic geothermal energy. After listening to this video lecture, you will be able to describe the geothermal energy source. You will be able to know the types of geothermal power station. You will be able to explain the ring of fire, and you will be able to discuss the global scenario of geothermal energy. Underneath the Earth's hard surface, known as crust, is the trapped molten mass of Earth, known as magma, which is present at about 1200 degrees centigrade. The crust varies in thickness ranging from 15 kilometer to 150 kilometer and insulates the Earth's outer surface and protects it from the intense heat of the magma. However, there are certain locations on Earth where the thickness of the crust is small, of the order of few hundred meters, and when the crust is cracked, subsoil water comes into contact with the hot matter and gets converted into steam or hot water. There are some locations in Iceland and in Himalayas where such natural hot water springs are found. In some other places, if we can drill through the crust over a kilometer or so, the hot matter can easily be reached, and by pumping water at pressure over this hot matter, it is possible to produce steam which can be collected and brought up to the Earth surface and used in a steam power cycle to produce electricity. Dear students, you might be knowing about the thermal power plant where we use the boiler where coal is burned, and after burning up coal, that heat is being utilized for converting water into steam. That high pressure, high temperature steam enters into the turbine, and because of the steam pressure, the turbine blade rotates, and the shaft of the turbine is also rotates, and a torque is created. The shaft of the turbine is coupled with the shaft of the generator, which in turn produces electricity, and the low pressure, low temperature steam coming out from the turbine enters into the condenser and converting it into water. That water is again pumped back to the boiler, thus completes the cycle. So this is the procedure for thermal power plant, but in geothermal power plant, the geothermal energy is being used for converting steam, and that steam is used in the turbine for rotating the blades of the turbine, and shaft of the turbine is coupled with the shaft of the generator, which in turn produces electricity. So let us discuss about different types of geothermal plants. Geothermal power is power generated by geothermal energy. Technologies in use include dry steam power station, flash steam power stations, and binary cycle power stations. So, today's discussion, we will mainly focus on these three power stations. Number one is dry steam power stations, flash steam power stations, and binary cycle power stations for geothermal power plant. Geothermal power stations are similar to other steam turbine thermal power stations, as I have already mentioned about the process for thermal power plant. For instance, heat from a fuel source. In geothermal case, the Earth's core is used to heat water or another working fluid. The working fluid is then used to turn a turbine of a generator, thereby producing electricity. The fluid is then cooled and returned to the heat source. So this is one figure for the geothermal power. So this type of power, geothermal power, you can see at different places in Iceland, in New Zealand, or some European countries, where you can see that the hot steam is coming out from the surface of the earth and it comes from deep inside from the earth core. Now we will tap this energy and see how we can produce electricity from the geothermal energy sources. Geothermal power is considered to be a sustainable, renewable source of energy because the heat extraction is small compared with the earth's heat content. The greenhouse gas emissions of geothermal electric stations are on average 45 grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour of electricity, or less than 5% of that of conventional coal-fired plants. So let us begin our discussion on the dry steam power stations, that is one type of the geothermal power plants. In certain location, dry steam issues out of the earth and it can be directly used in a conventional steam power plant with suitable accessories. Dry steam power directly uses geothermal steam of 150 degrees centigrade or greater to turn the turbine. The steam coming out of the geothermal well is carrying with it liquid water, sand and soil, and dissolved mineral matter from earth. These need to be separated before steam is fed to the turbine. Otherwise, the life of the turbine blades will be very much reduced due to erosion. The exhaust steam from the turbine is condensed in the condenser, and the condensate is either re-injected into the hot geothermal zone or used for preheat in process industries. Now, whatever I have discussed, you see the diagram, then it will be crystal clear for you. Basically, we are replacing the boiler, which actually producing the steam. But in this case, we are actually getting the steam from the geothermal energy resources. So you see that there are two well, one is production well, second one is injection well. Now, at the core of the earth or in the deep inside earth, the water is converted into steam because of the tremendous heat. That heat is being utilized for producing heat there itself, and that steam is coming out through the production well, and that steam is entering into the turbine, and the turbine shaft rotates, thereby torque is generated, and the shaft of the turbine is coupled to the shaft of the generator. Ultimately, it produces electricity. Now, after the expansion of the steam in the turbine, the low pressure, low temperature steam enters into the condenser and it condensed into liquid water, and after that the liquid water is injected through the injection well. So this is the procedure for dry steam power stations. Now let us talk about the flash steam power stations. These systems are employed in regions where hot water at high pressure and steam are received from the hot zones. This hot water is sent to a flash chamber, which produces steam at slightly lower pressure and temperature. This steam is used in the steam power cycle. Now you see that the hot water which is present deep inside the earth is having tremendous pressure. Because of the high pressure, it is in the liquid form. So this hot liquid water is passing through the producing valve because of the high pressure. Now as soon as it comes and enters into the flash chamber, but the flash chamber is on the surface of the earth, that pressure is just like the pressure of the atmospheric pressure. Because of the low pressure, the steam is generated from the hot water which is coming deep inside of the earth. The flash steam station pull deep high pressure hot water into lower pressure tanks and use the resulting flashed steam to drive turbines. They require fluid temperature of at least 180 degree centigrade, usually more. This is the most common type of station in operation today. The hot water flows up through wells in the ground under its own pressure. As it flows upward, the pressure decreases and some of the hot water boils into steam. The steam is then separated from the water and used to power a turbine generator. Any leftover water and condensed steam may be injected back into the reservoir, making this a potentially sustainable resource. So this is the diagram of flash steam power stations. Now you see deep inside the earth, the water is having a very high temperature of the order of 180 degree centigrade. But this will be in the liquid form because the pressure is very high. Now, as the hot water whose temperature is 180 degree centigrade comes out through the producing well and enters into the steam tank or flash chamber, because of the low pressure, when it enters into the flash chamber, some of the liquid immediately starts boiling and it will be in the steam form. So that steam enters the turbine and the rest of the process complex, and power is being generated, electricity is generated, and the low pressure, low temperature steam coming out from the turbine after expansion, it enters into the condenser, thereby it is condensed into liquid form, and that is again fed through the injection well into the deep inside the earth. Now we will talk about the binary cycle power station. Binary cycle power station are the most recent development and can accept fluid temperature as low as 57 degrees centigrade. The moderately hot geothermal water is passed by a secondary fluid with a much lower boiling point than water. This causes the secondary fluid to flash vaporize, which then drives the turbine. This is the most common type of geothermal electricity station being constructed today. The thermal efficiency of this type of station is typically about 10 to 13%. Now you see that the hot water coming out from deep inside the earth is temperature is only 57 degrees centigrade. As you all know that at atmospheric pressure, water boils at 100 degrees centigrade. So definitely the water whose temperature is only 57 degrees centigrade is in the liquid form. Now let us see the water whose temperature 57 degrees centigrade only, how we can use in the binary cycle power stations. This is the diagram for binary cycle power stations. Now, through the producing well, the hot water comes out and it enters into the heat exchanger. But the temperature of hot water is only around 57 to 60 degrees centigrade. But the other cycle, the binary cycle or the topping cycle, is having the working fluid that is butane or pentane. The properties of butane or pentane is their boiling point is very less. So they take heat in the while passing through the heat exchanger, or the water which is coming out from the earth crust, even though whose temperature is 57 degrees centigrade or 60 degrees centigrade, then while passing through the heat exchanger, the heat is being exchanged from the hot water to the fluid that is butane or pentane. Since the boiling point of pentane or butane, which is actually flowing in the binary cycle, it will start boiling because the boiling point of butane or pentane is much less. So, after taking heat from the hot water, the butane or pentane will start boiling, and that vapor will enters into the turbine, and the turbine blades will rotate. The shaft of the turbine is coupled to the shaft of the generator, which in turn producing electricity. Now, after the expansion of the working fluid in the binary cycle, it enters again through the heat exchanger, takes the heat from the hot water which is coming out from deep inside the earth crust. Again, it will be converting into vapor, and that vapor will again pass through the turbine, that completes the cycle. So, through the binary power cycle, we can also generate electricity through this process. Now, let us see that where is geothermal energy found? Found along major plate boundaries where earthquake and volcanoes are concentrated, like geyser, hot springs, fumaroles, geothermal reservoirs. These are the examples for the geothermal sources of energy. 70% comes from the decay of radioactive nuclei with long half-lives that are embedded within the earth. Some energy is from residual heat left over from earth's formation. The rest of the energy comes from meteorite impacts. Hot water reservoirs. You might have seen the hot water reservoirs at different parts in our country. Hot water reservoirs, as the name implies, these are reservoirs of hot underground water. They are more suited for space heating than for electricity production. Natural steam reservoirs, as we have discussed in our earlier discussion, to generate electricity by tapping steam from deep inside of the earth's core. So, natural steam reservoirs, in this case, a hole is dug into the ground, can cause steam to come to the surface. Geopressured reservoirs, in this type of reserve, brine completely saturated with natural gas is stored under pressure from the weight of overlying rock. This type of resource can be used for both heat and for natural gas. Normal geothermal gradient. At any place on the planet, there is a normal temperature gradient of 30 degrees centigrade per kilometer dug into the earth. Therefore, if one digs 6,000 meters, the temperature will be about 180 degrees centigrade above the surface temperature, because the gradient is 30 degrees centigrade per kilometer. 6,000 meter is equal to 6 kilometer. So 30 degree centigrade per kilometer is the temperature gradient. So 30 plus 6, that comes out to be 180 degree centigrade. So on the surface of the temperature, the water which is under 6 kilometer below, then the in the Earth's surface, that temperature will be 180 degree centigrade, because the temperature gradient is in general 30 degree centigrade per kilometer dug in the into the Earth. Hot dry rock, it is similar to normal geothermal gradient, but the gradient is 40 degree centigrade per kilometer dug underground. Molten magma, no technology exists to tap into the heat reserves stored in magma. Now let us talk about the ring of fire. Geothermal energy can sometimes find in way to the surface in the form of volcanoes and fumaroles, hot springs, geysers. The most active geothermal resources are usually found along major plates boundaries where earthquakes and volcanoes are concentrated. Most of the geothermal activity in the world occurs in an area called the Ring of Fire. This area rims the Pacific Ocean. So this is the diagram. You see that the in this diagram you can see that where the Ring of Fire is located in our country. You see that on the Himalayan belt, it shows that there is a possibility of Ring of Fires, where you can already there exist some hot springs. Now we will talk on scenario of geothermal energy in India. India has reasonably good potential for geothermal. The potential geothermal provinces can produce 10,600 megawatt of power. Though India has been one of the earliest countries to begin geothermal projects way back in the 1970s, that means around 50 years before India's, there are some places where geothermal projects were in operation. But at present, there are no operational geothermal plants in India, but research is going on. Scenario of geothermal energy in India. So more than 300 hot springs locations have been identified by Geological Survey of India. The surface temperature of hot springs ranges from 35 degree centigrade to as much as 98 degree centigrade. These hot springs have been grouped together and termed as different geothermal provinces based on their occurrences in the specific geotectonic regions, geographical and structural regions such as occurrence in organic belt regions, deep fault regions, active volcanic regions, etc. These springs are grouped into seven geothermal provinces in India, that is Himalayan Valley, Sahara Valley, Kambi Basin, Shon Narmada Tapi, West Ghat, West Coast, Godavari Basin and Mahanadi Basin. Now the potential sites: Puga Valley, that is located at JNK, Tatapani, that is located at Chhattisgarh, Godavari Basin, Manikaran, that is located at Himachal Pradesh. But Manikaran is a place that is very near to Kullu Manali. Their hot springs are there. There is a place that is known as Bakkeshwar, that is in West Bengal, Tuwa, that is in Gujarat, Unnai, that is at Maharashtra, and Jalgaon, and located at Maharashtra. So these are the potential sites for geothermal energy. Geothermal energy is thermal energy generated and stored in the earth. India's installed capacity of geothermal energy is experimental and commercial use is insignificant. According to some ambitious estimate, India has a potential of 10,600 megawatt in the geothermal provinces, but it still needs to be exploited. India has potential resources to harvest geothermal energy. Now, geothermal research centers. MESHY India, MESHY India acts as technical arm to government institutional in the conduction of scientific and geothermal research projects and simulates new research and development projects in collaborations with Indian national research institutions and international organizations, in particular in the field of techniques and earthquake mechanisms, reservoir induced seismicity, advanced mining hazards, underground waste storage, etc. Geological Survey of India, that is also a research center for geothermal energy sources, the National Geographical Research Institute located at Hyderabad. Reliability of geothermal energy. Geothermal is a reliable source of energy. It is also one of the most important renewable energy. Geothermal energy also has many advantages when compared to other renewable sources like solar, wind or biomass. It is an exceptionally constant source of energy and it is not dependent on neither wind nor sun and available all year long. Advantages and disadvantages of geothermal energy. There are advantages like theoretically inexhaustible energy source. Enormous energy sources are there in geothermal energy resources. Often an excellent supplement to other renewable sources. Does not require structural structures such as solar panels or windmills. Energy is continuously available and more dependable than other solar or wind energy. Capital and running costs are lower compared to nuclear and coal-based thermal power plants, less polluting compared to conventional thermal power plant. Limitations of geothermal energy. Dissolved solids in water or steam causes problems of separations. Complete separations of solid is not possible and hence restrict the life of the turbine blades. May cause ground surface or ground water pollution if effluents are not injected back to the wells. Of course, it is done through the injection well after it is done work through the turbine. Not available in many locations, not much power per wind. The extraction of geothermal energy from the grounds leads to a release of greenhouse gases like hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide, methane and ammonia. However, the amount of gas released is significantly lower than in the case of fossil fuels. So, today we have discussed about the geothermal energy sources. You might have seen how the geothermal energy is used for producing electricity through different techniques. So, let us summarize what we have discussed in today's discussion. We have started with geothermal energy sources, the types of geothermal power stations, the ring of fire, and finally, we have discussed the advantages and limitations of geothermal energy sources. Thank you very much. So, in the next class, we will talk about a very interesting topic, that is cogeneration plant. Till then, so if you have any questions, you can ask in our next lecture. Thank you very much.